Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on the steps of thyroid hormone synthesis. The thyroid hormones are obviously synthesized by the thyroid gland. The gland is structured in a manner that fits the job description. Microscopically, the parenchyma consists of lots of follicles. These thyroid follicles are lined by epithelium and filled with colloid. The gland is divided into lobules by septa, consisting of connective tissue with nerves, lymphatics, and importantly, blood vessels. The capillaries here are fenestrated, and that's how the hormones synthesized reach systemic circulation. These cells are the ones that make the thyroid hormones. They are the follicular epithelial cells, or thyrocytes. And when you're studying the steps of this synthesis, it can get overwhelming, but hopefully I can help you out a bit. Let's start with what these hormones are. The thyroid hormones are amine hormones. They are derived from an amino acid, tyrosine. I know chemical structures can get frustrating, but bear with me, this will actually make understanding the rest easier. So this is tyrosine, and to synthesize the thyroid hormone, it has to get iodinated. Iodine is going to be added to this structure stepwise. When we add 1, that's monoiodotyrosine, MIT. That's because it just has 1. When we add 2, it'll become diiodotyrosine, DIT, because it has 2. Now we'll try joining them. If we put 1 monoiodotyrosine with 1 diiodotyrosine together, we get a structure that looks something like this, with 3 iodine additions. This position is 3 and 5 of the inner ring, and this is 3 prime and 5 prime of the outer ring. That makes this structure 3, 5, 3 prime triiodothyronine, abbreviated as T3. Instead, if we put 2 diiodotyrosines together, we get 4 additions. That's 3, 5, 3 prime, 5 prime tetraiodothyronine, or thyroxine, abbreviated as T4. So we have MIT, DIT, T3, and T4. There's one more that I'm going to add here. Instead of the inner ring, if it's the outer ring of T3 that has 2 iodine, that is called reverse T3. And reverse T3 hasn't got any functions in the body. MIT and DIT are not physiologically active either. T3 is active, and T4 gets activated to T3 in the periphery. I'll get to that, but it's mainly this T3 that has physiological actions in the body. Those are important thyroid hormones, and now we'll see how the thyroid gland synthesizes them. I've broken it down into 10 steps. Step 1, the layout. So we need the follicular epithelial cell for this, since that's where synthesis is going to happen. This is the lumen with colloid, the storage, and this is the capillary, systemic circulation. The colloid is where the cell stores the hormone, meaning the storage here is extracellular. That is special to the thyroid gland. It stores the hormone outside the cell instead of inside. And this cell has polarity, which is important. The apical membrane faces the lumen with the colloid, and the basolateral membrane faces the capillary. Now this cell is going to synthesize proteins and put that in the colloid. So that's where the hormone gets stored, and when the gland gets stimulated to secrete the hormone, it's going to take up the colloid and transfer the proteins to blood and thus systemic circulation. So in the first half, we're going to go from the basolateral to the apical membrane. And in the second half, the other way around, from the apical to the basolateral membrane. For it to synthesize the hormones, it needs 2 things, iodine and tyrosine. Where does the iodine come from? That's step 2, iodide trapping. Iodine comes from diet, it's a trace element. From circulation, that cell needs to take up iodine, and it does that using a transporter, the sodium iodide cotransporter, or a symporter. NIS for short. This is going to bring iodide and sodium into the cell from the plasma by active transport. The cell has a large amount of iodine. It concentrates it. The ratio of thyroid iodine to serum iodine is around 20:30:1, so you can see it's much higher in the thyroid gland than it is in the serum. That means it's going to have to move from low to high concentration against the electrochemical gradient, and that's why it's using an active transporter. The energy for this movement comes from sodium, because there's also a sodium-potassium ATPase on the basolateral membrane that sends three sodium ions out of the cell and two potassium ions into it, creating a concentration gradient for sodium to enter the cell from high to low. This is secondary active transport, and it moves two sodium ions and one iodide ion into the cell. Now that iodide anion is inside the cell. On to step three, we also need tyrosine. That's by the synthesis of thyroglobulin. This is a protein-synthesizing cell. It has rough endoplasmic reticulum and a well-defined Golgi apparatus to synthesize a protein with lots of tyrosine. That is our thyroglobulin. It's a large glycoprotein that gets incorporated into secretory vesicles and then extruded across the apical membrane, entering the follicular lumen. So a major component of this colloid is that thyroglobulin. It forms a substrate for the synthesis of thyroid hormones. But iodide is still in the cell, while thyroglobulin is in the colloid. So step four is iodide oxidation. There is a transporter on the apical membrane called pendrin, which is supposed to be a sodium-independent chloride-iodide countertransporter, meaning they're going to go in opposite directions. So it sends iodide out of the cell and into the lumen in exchange for chloride. The iodide has now just reached the follicular lumen, but there's something waiting for it there: thyroid peroxidase. This enzyme is an integral protein in the apical membrane, and it's going to take that negative iodide anion and convert it to iodine. That's oxidation. This process requires hydrogen peroxide, which is provided by another set of proteins on the membrane called dual oxidases, DuOx1 and DuOx2. This thyroid peroxidase is an important enzyme in the synthesis pathway, not just for this step, but because it's needed for the next few steps as well. But now iodide is in the lumen and it's been oxidized to iodine. Step 5 is the organification of thyroglobulin. So now the two ingredients needed for the synthesis of the thyroid hormone, that's iodine and tyrosine, are in the colloid. Organification would just be a fancy way of saying we're going to add the iodine to the thyroglobulin. With one molecule of iodine, we form monoiodotyrosine. With two, that's diiodotyrosine, MIT and DIT. And they stay attached to the thyroglobulin molecule. Again, this step needs thyroid peroxidase, as does the next step. That's step 6, when these two undergo a coupling reaction. Remember what happens when they combine? MIT and DIT form T3, and two DIT molecules form T4. That process is called coupling. Again, it uses thyroid peroxidase. But this reaction, the formation of thyroxine, T4, it is 10 times faster than the formation of T3. The thyroid gland, thus in the end, is going to secrete more T4 than T3. Nearly 90% of it is going to be T4. Not all of them undergo coupling, though. So now we have a thyroglobulin with attached MIT, DIT, T3, and T4, and it's going to stay like that until the gland is stimulated to secrete the thyroid hormones. It does that by step 7, that's endocytosis of thyroglobulin. The thyroid gland gets stimulated by an appropriately named hormone, the thyroid stimulating hormone, TSH. This TSH comes from the anterior pituitary, and we'll look at that in part 4. But when TSH stimulates this gland, it's going to send out pseudopods from the apical membrane. Those arms close around some colloid and bring it into the cell by endocytosis. So we have a vesicle with thyroglobulin and its four attachments. The cell has lysosomes, which fuse with these vesicles. The proteases inside the lysosome digest the bonds between the proteins, that's proteolysis, releasing T3 and T4 near the basolateral membrane. They diffuse into capillaries and enter systemic circulation. So thyroglobulin was endocytosed and T3 and T4 have been released. But what happens to the rest? That's step 8, deiodination. A lot of the iodinated tyrosine doesn't actually become T3 and T4. Remember that they stay as MIT and DIT. Once T3 and T4 are released, a thyroid deiodinase breaks this down, releasing iodide and tyrosine. This is an iodotyrosine deiodinase, which will remove iodide from tyrosine. The iodide is going to be added back to the intracellular pool. The tyrosine is going to be used to synthesize new thyroglobulin. Thus, it's all getting recycled. And all of this can be used in the next cycle because it's going to happen all over again. Now, the cell's job is done, but there's a little more to the process left. Step 9, transport. Now that T3 and T4 are in the plasma, they have to get transported in blood to reach their target cells, which are in different areas of the body. They could be free when they travel around like this, but most of them are bound to proteins. Three names you gotta remember here: the thyroxine-binding globulin, TBG, transthyretin, also called the thyroxine-binding prealbumin, and albumin. The highest affinity is with TBG. So most of the thyroid hormone is bound. It's the free hormones, though, that can act on tissues. The free hormones are the ones that are physiologically active. Different conditions can affect the levels of this thyroxine-binding globulin. Side note here, this is the thyroxine-binding globulin, TBG, which is a transporter. The backbone for hormone synthesis that we saw earlier, that's thyroglobulin, TG. They sound very similar, but it's important that you note the difference between the two. But very simply, if the levels of TBG reduce, the amount of free hormone goes up. If there's more TBG, the amount bound goes up and the free hormone levels come down. But once they reach the target cells, it's actually T3 that's going to be more active than T4. Most of the hormone produced by the thyroid gland, however, was T4, and we need more T3. That's taken care of in step 10, peripheral activation. We're almost at the end here. In organs like the liver, kidney, and skeletal muscles, there is a deiodinase. This is going to remove the iodine from the outer or inner ring of T4. That converts T4 to T3 if it removes it from the outer ring, or reverse T3 if it removes it from the inner ring. Reverse T3, remember, isn't active in the body. It's this T3 which is active, and it's going to go and bind to the nuclear receptors of the target cells and synthesize proteins. That's how it exerts its effects in different parts of the body, like on carbohydrate, fat, and protein metabolism, bone growth and maturation, brain development, etc. That's two deiodinases. The important one converting T4 to active T3 is a type 1 deiodinase. The type 3 deiodinase is an inactivating one. It converts T4 to reverse T3, which is not biologically active. The type 1 deiodinase has a low affinity for T4, but in organs such as the anterior pituitary, there's another deiodinase, the type 2 deiodinase. Now, this is a high affinity one. It can convert T4 locally, that means in the tissue itself, to T3. And that's important for regulation, since sensing that T3 is how the anterior pituitary decides what to do with TSH. And it's that TSH that tells the thyroid gland what to do. This is important for regulation of the thyroid gland, which starts even higher than that with a hypothalamus. And that's what we'll look at in part 4, where we put everything together with the hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis. For all those 10 steps, that's how thyroid hormones are synthesized and secreted. I hope this video was helpful. If it was, you can give it a like and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.